I want to invite your attention to the book of Deuteronomy. That is not in the New Testament. Amen. That's in the beginning of the Old Testament, if you will. Deuteronomy chapter 11. Deuteronomy chapter 11. And we're going to begin with verse 10. Deuteronomy chapter 11. And beginning with verse 10. Once you have it, would you say amen, signifying by saying amen if you have it?
Amen.
If you're still turning, say wait.
Wait.
Now, Linda, you said wait, but you're not turning. I said, if you don't have it. All right. Verse 10 reads, "The land you are entering to take over is not like the land of Egypt, from which you came, where you planted your seeds and irrigated it with by foot as in a vegetable garden. But the land you are crossing the Jordan to take possession of is a land of mountains and valleys that drinks rain from heaven. It is a land the Lord your God cares for. The eyes of the Lord your God are continually on it from the beginning of the year to its end." So if you faithfully obey the commands I am giving to you today, to love the Lord your God and to serve him with all of your heart and with all of your soul, then I will send rain on your land in its season, both autumn and spring rains, so that you may gather in your grain, new wine and olive oil. I will provide grass in the fields for your cattle, and you will eat and be satisfied. I want to talk to you this morning on the subject, moving forward with God. Moving forward with God. Father, I pray now that you would illuminate your truth to our hearts and our minds. And Father, as our hearts and minds have been cultivated through worship, through giving, fellowship, now our hearts are ready to receive the word of God. I pray, O God, that you would pour into us as you did to the children of Israel. Help us to be receptive vessels and to have receptive hearts to receive the truth of God and to really walk into the blessing and to move forward with everything that God wants to give us. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Moving forward with God. All throughout these first five books of the Bible, Genesis, Exodus, and now looking at the book of Deuteronomy, you find many stories, many situations, many scenarios that reflect on the children of Israel and their involvement with Jehovah God. You look and you see how they were instructed by the Lord to prepare themselves for what God had for them. They were a people on a journey. They were a people on the move. They were not settled. They were not settlers. Yet many tried to settle in Egypt. Many tried to stay in Egypt. Many complained when it was time to leave Egypt. But they did not understand that to be God's people, you got to be moving where God wants you to move. In order to be God's people, you got to go when God says go. We are on a journey, and Israel reflects that journey, that moving, that shifting, that all of us today as Christians, 21st century Christians, can identify with, because even though we live in the United States of America, we have our address, we have our homes, we have our our lives, our careers, and in many regards, we've gotten settled. And so much so that even if God were to tell us to uproot and to do this and do that, or go here or go there, many of us would have a struggle leaving what is, because we have, in our mind, settled ourselves despite the will of God for our lives. In many regards, we need to check ourselves this morning to find out just how flexible and how pliable, how usable we are when it comes to the program of God. Because you do realize that God still has a sovereign will to tell us to go here, to tell us to go there. Our life is not our own. We are bought with a price. We belong to God. And while that's easy to understand, that sounds like good preaching, good church. But the reality of the matter is, think about all the things in our lives that are affected by that reality. Think about all the things that would become immediate emergencies in our lives, struggles in our lives, if God were to actually bring a change of order. We, like the children of Israel, are not settlers. We are not dwellers. This is not our home. Israel had not found their home yet. Israel had not found the place that God had promised them yet. You see, their dwelling place was directly linked to the promise of God to Abraham. It involved the people that had to be cultivated to understand where they were going. It involved the land. It involved the place. It involved a geographical spot that God had guaranteed to them. It involved Canaan, this place of blessing, place of promise. But it was not without problems. Amen. And anytime you and I are moving into the will of God for our lives, we're going to face problems. Anytime God is taking us from point A to point B, whenever God is taking us from one place of development to the next place of development, it's not without problems. It's not without challenges. Expect there to be some rough times. Expect there to be some tears that are being shed. Expect there to be some struggle, some fighting along the way.
Amen.
Because anytime God moves us from one place to the next, don't underestimate the enemy who wants to keep us in a settled position illegally. Don't underestimate the enemy that wants to keep us illegally occupying a place that is not ours in nature. God has a place for us. And the Israelites show us today and give us a clear view of what it means to be a pilgrim. To be a pilgrim passing through. A pilgrim passing through foreign territory, but moving towards their possession. Why are you saved today? Why am I saved today? Why are we connected to God today? Why do we know Jesus Christ today? Here's a simplified version. Because he's taken us somewhere.
That's right.
He's taken us somewhere. You see, many Christians get saved for the wrong reason. Folk get on their knees and cry out to God and confess Jesus as their Savior and Lord with a misunderstanding that he's going to come and help me to accomplish what I've always dreamed of. I'm glad I'm saved today because I've got somebody to help me fulfill my own dreams and to help me unfold my own plans. And everything on my wish list, he's going to meet every one of those things. You know, they come to God with that type of misconception as if God is going to make everything that they desire, that they want, that they are looking for, that they plan. He's going to make all those things become reality. And we even have preachers today. That will stand in the pulpits and behind cameras and on national television and preach such fallacy to the point where people are drawn towards a gospel that has lost its meaning. A Christianity that does not contain Christ. You can go and get a life coach to help you attain your own selfish ambitions. You got coaches here, coaches there, people that will come alongside you for a small fee and help you become the greatest you could ever be. Yeah. Till you get to a ripe old age and you're satisfied with yourself, but where are you with God? Yes. And where does Christ really become Christ in your life? I mean to tell you that We move not because of our own plans. Our journey is not orchestrated by our own personal GPS device. Our journey is calculated, is already determined because of God's divine will for our lives.
Amen.
And you and I are learning, growing, discovering what it means to really follow Jesus, to move forward. You see, because if you and I are left at the steering wheel, we'll find ourselves moving backwards rather than moving forward.
That's right.
I don't want to be a part of anything. I don't know about you, but I don't want to be a part of anything that's not progressive. I don't want to be a part of any organization that's not progressive. I don't want to work in a business that's not progressive.
Amen.
I don't even want to come to a church that's not progressive.
Amen.
Let the church say amen.
Amen.
I believe you were here because there's something going on.
Yes.
I believe God has you here because there's something progressive that God is tangibly doing, spiritually doing. Listen, he's moving us from one level of understanding, one level of life, one level of usage, to another level of experiencing the progressive nature of God.
Yes.
Why do we pray for healing in our bodies? Because we want to see progress. If not, let's not pray for healing. Let's just die. Let's just give in. Give up. But the reality of the matter is that we ourselves want to be progressive even in our physical body, even in our personal lives. We want to see progress, and rightfully so. God designs and desires us as a body, as born-again believers, to move forward. To move forward, to find ourselves in a progressive state, to find ourselves progressively growing, to find ourselves progressively pursuing the journey that is set before us by God.
Yes, sir.
Amen.
Because God's taken us somewhere. Turn to your neighbor and tell him he's taken you somewhere.
Amen.
Hello.
Can't see with the naked eye, but with the eye of faith, you're able to see where God is taking you and what God wants to do in your life. And I believe with that same eye of faith, you can look in your past and you can see where the Lord has brought you from.
Yeah.
Any indicator that you moved, that you shifted, that you've grown, that you're moving forward, look where he's brought you from. Forget the past. Don't ignore the past. Don't X out the past. The past serves as a tutor in your life now that you have moved from where you used to be.
Yes. Yes. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
And just as you're no longer the same, you will no longer be the same.
My Lord.
As you continue to move forward with God.
Yes, sir. Yes.
But here's the thing. You and I have to move forward not because of our own ideas, not because of the persuasion of the world or the culture, not because of other people, not because of what somebody else is doing or what it looks like in someone else's life, but we're moving forward because of what God is doing in our lives.
Yes.
You see, progress is only progress when we understand that God's hand is on it.
My Lord.
Because that can't nobody take you nowhere but God.
Yes.
The devil ain't got no plan of progressing for your life.
No,
he wants to kill, steal, and destroy. That ain't progressive.
Yes.
Going in a downward spiral is not making progress.
Amen.
He wants to rob you. He wants to pull the wool over your eyes. He wants to strip you of everything that God has given to you. He wants to make you a shameful, pitiful experience. Listen, example of someone following God. He wants to strip us. He wants to sift us like wheat, the Bible says.
Yes.
He wants to shake us down to almost nothing.
Yes.
The enemy would love for every day of our lives for us to close our Bibles and stay off of our knees and disconnect from the God that is taking us somewhere and make us feel as if we are here all alone.
That's right.
That's right.
You say, preacher, how is that possible? There are so many believers today that have disconnected, listen, from the reality of who God is in their lives and who he wants to be. And they have become self-centered. They have imposed. You know how a building falls down? And sometimes if they orchestrate the dynamite just right, it will fall in on itself. Implode. And this is what, listen, many believers are experiencing. They are so self-consumed that they are destroying themselves because they refuse to connect back with the God that's taken them somewhere.
Yes, yes.
You see, it's dangerous to get off a bus before the bus stops.
Yes.
Y'all come on, talk to me today.
Yes.
Common sense.
Yes.
Common sense tells you, don't get off before it stops. But there's so many today that have, listen, taken a step that God didn't say take. There's so many believers today that have taken moves and shifts in their lives as if God has orchestrated it and as if God has stopped the bus and sanctioned the detour. God has not stopped. God will not stop until you and I become just what he wants us to be. Oh, come on, y'all can say amen better than that.
Amen.
Some of us have stopped believing.
Yes, sir.
We stopped trusting. We stopped praying. We stopped expecting.
Yes, sir.
We come to the same church, sit in the same seats with absolutely no expectation of change, no expectation of growth, no expectation of the miraculous. I want to tell you today, wake up your faith. You're still on the bus, and God's still taking you somewhere.
Amen.
We're going somewhere with God.
We're
going somewhere with God because he still has a plan for our lives. We got to trust him every step of the way. When we look at the children of Israel, he talks to them about the land that he's preparing them for. You see, you and I, for the next level of our lives, have to understand the new things, the great things, the glorious things that God has prepared for us. I'm not just talking about heaven.
That's right.
But I'm talking about right here and right now. Because our expectation doesn't just need to be towards eternity, but our expectation ought to be daily. I'm going to say that again.
Yes,
stop just expecting heaven. Heaven is going to be there. Heaven ain't going nowhere. We got a guarantee on that. When we're saved eternally. That's a done deal. But what about the day-to-day expectations that God designs and desires us to have as we connect with God, trust God, believe God every single day? In other words, there's something that God is preparing you for this week.
Yes.
Next month. 6 months from now.
Yes, sir.
Next year.
Yes.
5 years from now. You see, God's got some stuff on his divine calendar that has your name on it, my name on it, this church's name on it, and we've got to be ready for that season.
Yes.
Got to possess it, but you got to be ready to possess it. Look at verse 10. It says, the land you are entering. Here's where you're going. But the land that you're going to, the land that you're entering to take over, is not like the land of Egypt. First thing he said, listen, the land that you're going to is not like where you came from.
Yes, sir.
Where I've taken you is not like where you've been. You see, a whole lot of folk need to understand that principle. What God is up to in your life is totally different about, it's totally different than where you have come from.
Yes, my Lord.
So please don't compare it. It is totally different in nature. God's blessing is so much greater than your past.
Come on, man.
He says, listen, it's not like the land of Egypt from which you have come, where you planted your seed and irrigated it by foot as in a vegetable garden. Notice what he says. Listen. First of all, I want you to see in this first category, we're talking about God's provision. He now takes them to an understanding of Egypt, which they're well acquainted with, and he says, listen, where I'm taking you, Canaan is not like Egypt, but here's what your Egypt experience was like. It was a land where you, listen, your main source of water was from the Nile River. I want you to get these characteristics, get these details. The main source of water for Egypt was the Nile River. And the Nile River annually, I mean once a year, would flood and overflood its banks. And listen, it would renew and refresh the soil so that they were able to continue to plant and to harvest crops. So they were dependent upon the water of the Nile River. But not only that, they began, listen, they constructed these irrigation systems, man-made irrigation systems that were pedaled, the Bible says, by foot, that would cause water, listen, to be pushed in certain directions. So they basically had made a man-made irrigation system for their own fields and crops so that they would have what they needed to have, but it came with a man-made price. That was your Egypt experience. In other words, you had to work for it. You had to make it happen. How many of us before we came to Christ had to work hard? Had to make stuff happen. Didn't make sense, but we stayed in it anyhow. And some of it, listen, we are out of the will of God, but we were working. And many times, if you be honest, you were working too hard for something that wasn't even going to come back to you. Working for something that wasn't even yours. Working hard for something that wasn't even a guarantee. Work gambling, wasting all your money, ain't got a bit of a guarantee attached to it. But you having a time of your life, just cha-ching, cha-ching, maybe today, cha-ching, cha-ching, and ain't got no change in your pocket. Y'all ain't gonna be real with me today. Folk out there drinking. I'm having a good old time. Killing my liver, Lord have mercy, kidneys failing, but I'm having a good old time. Can't remember where I live or what my name is, but I'm having a good old time. I'm losing all my friends, but I'm happy by myself. Fooling yourself because you think because you're doing all this that you're going to get some kind of reward for it. Let me tell you something, you're fooling yourself. You see, sin will have you working harder for stuff that ain't even yours. And stuff that will never come to you. It's an illusion. It's an illusion of grandeur. It's an illusion of blessings. But when God blesses you, you don't have to work for it. Come on, talk to me. You don't have to work for God's blessings. When God blesses you with salvation, did you have to work for it? I said, when God blessed you with salvation, did you have to work for it? No, because salvation is a gift. Salvation is a free gift. No strings attached. He's not coming back to you knocking on your door. Say, time to pay up. No, when Jesus gave you his blessing of salvation, he gave it to you as a free gift.
Thank you, Jesus.
And the benefit is ours. The blessing is ours. See, Egypt represents the world. Egypt represents the world. Where you got to work hard for something that's not a guarantee. But here's what God says. Listen, the land you came from was like that. You had to make it happen. But I'm taking you into a land, verse 11. You are crossing the Jordan to take possession of a land of mountains and valleys that drinks, listen to this, that drinks rain from heaven. So let's talk about the irrigation system. Let's talk about the water supply here. See, Egypt had a river, and you had to wait for an annual flooding to get a benefit from what took place in that type of environment. But the land that I've taken to you now is not just a flat land, but it's a land with mountains and valleys. And you know anything about mountains and valleys. See, there's some fertile, plush places where you can plant crops and grow vineyards and have all kinds of nice things that you can receive from the land because it has a built-in irrigation system with the mountains, the water and the snow-capped mountains and the water, and listen, thaws and flows down into the streams and you get some of your best water from those regions. And what's that water that we like, Shanita, in the what is it called? Fiji. I don't know where it's from, but it says on the back it's from somewhere. Fiji. I love that water because it's nice and crystal clear. But listen, I can imagine the water from these regions being crystal clear because God says, listen, it is watered from heaven. The water from heaven, God supplies the need. When you go where I'm taking you, when you stay on the bus long enough to get to my destination for you, I'll provide for everything you stand in need of. Are you listening to me, church? Because I asked a question about 15 minutes ago about health needs, and I saw the majority of the hands in the room go up.
Amen.
And I'm here to tell you, take yourself and your need and listen, stay with God long enough for him to get you to where he wants you to be. And here's what I'm telling you based upon the authority of God's word. He'll meet every one of your needs as long as you and I are in the will of God.
Yes.
You see, faith will keep you on that bus, but fear will have you get off before it's your stop. And what do you do when you get off prematurely? Oh, I thought this was my street. Lord, what do I do now? Oh, God, I got to call somebody. I got to make arrangements. I need an Uber. I need a taxi. I need help because I don't know where I am, and I don't know how to function. You know how it is when we're not where we were supposed to be. We lose all functionability. We don't even know how to proceed. We don't know how to think straight because we're consumed with the idea of being lost. Stay with God. Keep your faith connected to God. Don't get off before it's your stop, because God has a purpose and a plan for your journey. Stay forward. Stay moving forward with God, because number one, God is your provider.
Yes, he is.
You don't want to get off prematurely, folks, because God promised that he'll meet every one of your needs. James chapter 1 and verse 17 says this: every good and perfect gift comes from above, coming down from the Father of the heavenly lights, who does not change like shifting shadows. In other words, you can depend upon him. He will always be faithful to his word. He won't change on you. He won't pull out on you. He won't change his mind towards you. Stay connected to the reality that all of your needs come met from God. You see, many of us get back to this Egypt mindset, this slavery mindset, this worldly mindset that I have to make my life go round. I have to make my world go round. And I'm not saying being lazy and do nothing. No, faith is not being lazy. Faith is doing what God says to do, even when it doesn't make sense to do it.
Yeah.
I'm going to say that again. Faith is not being lazy. Faith is progressive. Faith is doing what God says to do, even when it doesn't make sense to do it. Because at the end of the day, it's going to get you to the place that God has for you.
Yes.
And you and I have to trust God and be obedient to God's word by faith.
Amen.
Because every good and perfect gift comes from God. He's our provider. What about you today? What about us today? What about our lives today? God's taking us somewhere. Yeah, we're going to heaven one day, but we ain't dead yet. So let's talk about the here and now. Let's talk about what God is doing. See, Canaan doesn't just represent heaven. Canaan represents a state of mind for the believer right now. The Bible says that you and I, listen, are a part and have a part of this abundant life that God came to give us. And again, I've said this before many times, that does not refer to heaven in eternity. That's your life and my life right now, as long as God has us here. The abundance of God's mercy, God's grace, God's love, God's power, everything that God has at his disposal and who he is in nature is, listen, is to become reality in our lives today. I don't preach a gospel in the great by and by where we just wait to get to heaven and we just sing a little ditty here today, have a good time, and wait to die. That's not a progressive church. That's not a progressive message. That's not a progressive reality. You and I have to understand that God has a purpose for the journey on this planet, the journey of this life, the journey of this existence. The reason why he's put breath in your body and given you life one more day is so that you can continue this leg of the journey.
Yes, sir.
He's taking you somewhere. You say, preacher, what about my needs? What about my needs? Well, I'm glad you asked that question. Philippians 4:19, and my God shall supply all your needs according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. He'll take care of everything that concerns you because he is your sole provider. Your provider. Have you gotten off the bus prematurely? Have you gotten off of the journey? Have you stopped along the way for some illegal reason? You see, fear is illegal for the believer. Worry is illegal for the believer. Doubt is illegal for the believer. You and I can't stop because of these earthly things. We've got to stay connected to God and stay connected to his will for our lives. God is our provider. But look at verse 12. Verse 12 says this. It is a land the Lord your God cares for. The eyes of the Lord your God are continually on it from the beginning of the year to its end. Well, see, here it goes deeper. Not only is he our provider externally, but listen, it moves a lot closer. Look at verse 12. He says, the eyes of the Lord are on this land. The eyes of the Lord. Now we're talking about the presence of God. Not just the provision of God, but God's presence. Because his eyes, listen, reflect his attention. His eyes is where he's focused. Is what concerns him, what delights him, what he's getting ready to move, the region he's getting ready to move in. His eyes reflect his presence. The Bible says that he cares for this land. In other words, not just the soil, not just the trees, but he cares for the program that he has for this place, which involves people. What's he saying to Israel? He's saying, listen, God cares for you so much that he's going to make sure that you have everything that you need.
Amen.
Where? Where God has for you. God's will for you. God's will, beloved, is the safest place for your life today. God's will, if you are out of God's will, you are out of the scope of God's all-seeing care and his provision. You have stepped off the bus illegally when God says, stay focused because my power and provision is only allocated to the area of my will. You get out of God's will, you jeopardize your protection. You get out of God's will, you jeopardize God's presence being close to you because sin separates us from the presence of God. Fellowship with God. When you get out of God's will, you jeopardize the provision of God. And things become just like Egypt. You got to work yourself. You got to make it happen yourself. And God says, I'm coming to deliver you not just to a land, a geographic location, but I'm coming to deliver you from a mindset and a heart that is tied up in Egypt. You see, when the children of Israel came out of Egypt, they came out because God said it's time to come out. But a whole lot of them took Egypt in their hearts.
That's right.
Are you understanding what I'm saying?
Yes.
They came out with an Egyptian mentality. They came out with a bondage mentality. They came out with a slavery mentality. They came out with a worldly mentality. They came out with a whole lot of ideas that were attached to Egypt, the world, slavery, the place of bondage. Whenever God delivers you and delivers me, he delivers us and wants to deliver us from the mindset that draws us back there, that makes it convenient to go there. God says, I want every part of you brought out of Egypt.
Yes.
Amen.
Beloved, today God is saying the same thing to you and I. You and I have been saved by the grace of God. We've been saved by the mercy of God. We've been saved by the blood of Jesus Christ. He has stepped in where no man can step in to deliver us from the clutches of Satan himself, set us free that we might have a new experience with God. He's provided all of our needs through the power and the filling of the Holy Spirit. And now he says, listen, if you stay with me, my presence will make sure that you have what you need. His eye is on you. His eye is on you. His ear is attentive to you. Psalm 33 and 18 says, yes, but the eye of the Lord's on, the eye of the Lord is on those who fear him, yes. On those who hope in his unfailing love. Yes. I love that because he says his eye are on those who fear him. Oh, church, let me ask you this morning, do you fear God? Yes. Do you fear God? Because if you fear God, if you reverence God, if you have a holy respect for who God is and a respect for those, listen, the things that God wants to do in your life, you're going to go somewhere.
Amen.
Because his eye is on you. His ear is open to you. You know, when I was a teenager and I was catching the bus to school, you can talk, you can have fun on the bus with your friends, but one thing you don't do, you don't mess with the bus driver. Why? Because if you mess with the bus driver, you might just jeopardize the safety of everybody on that bus. You throw something at that bus driver, hit him in the head, and they lose control. Then there goes the whole bus.
Yes.
So you respect the bus driver.
Yes.
Give some respect to the bus driver.
That's right.
And it's what God is saying. Listen, my eye is on you. If you fear me, if you respect me, if you reverence me, if you worship me, if you honor me, if you put me in a place, listen, where I am number one in your life, that's how you honor me. That's how you fear me. Listen, I will keep you safe. I will keep you taken care of. I will supply all of your needs because my presence is with you. But you got to respect me. How do you fear God? You keep his commandments.
Right.
Not just saying it with lip service. Lord, I love you. Lord, I fear you. Lord, I thank you. Lord, I serve you. But listen, you actually do what God says do.
Right. Amen.
Y'all mighty quiet on me this morning.
Right.
Y'all didn't know this before?
Yeah.
He says, if you love me, keep my commandments.
Right.
He didn't say, if you love me, say it a whole bunch. No, he said, if you love me, prove it. Do what I've told you to do. Live the way I told you to live. Honor me the way I told you to honor me. If you love me, buckle down and do what my word says to do.
Amen.
That's not popular today.
No.
There's a whole lot of folk today that want to claim they love Jesus Christ, but they don't want to fear God.
That's right.
Whole lot of folk want God to bless them. Lord, bless me, bless me, bless me. I'm praying the prayer of Jabez, and I pray, enlarge my territory, and give me this, and give me that. I'm here to tell you, God wants to bless you as long as you do what he tells you to do.
Amen.
But stop asking God to bless you when you ain't doing what he tells you to do.
Amen.
Amen. It's just as simple as that. Buckle down, and let's honor God by being obedient to what his word says. Many times we say, we make excuses, well, I just can't do it, or I'm struggling, or this or that. Listen, how many excuses do we have to give God before we become obedient followers of what his word clearly says?
Amen.
Because the reality of the matter is that God's blessing, God's presence, God's provision is attached to obedience.
Amen.
God's provision is attached to obedience. That's important for us to understand because that's what he says. Psalm 84:11. Here's another one. He says, for the Lord God is a sun and shield. The Lord will give grace and glory. No good thing will he withhold from those who walk upright. I love that verse. No good thing will God withhold. In other words, no good thing will he keep from your life. No good thing will he not add to your life if you and I are following him.
Yes.
Because his eyes.
Yes, sir.
His eyes. Again, we're not talking about trees and dirt. His eyes are on the righteous. His eyes are on the righteous. New Testament context, Matthew 6:31-33 talks about needs, provision, worry, doubt. He says this, don't worry, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For the pagans, the unbelievers, they run after these things. He says, and your heavenly Father, here's the key, your heavenly Father knows that you need these things.
That's right.
Here's the answer. Seek first. first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you.
Yes.
What is God saying? I want y'all to get this. I want y'all to get this. What is God saying? You and I got to honor God first. You and I have to understand that his presence, his vision, his scope, his focus is on our lives. Not to find out what we're doing wrong. But his eyes are on the righteous because he wants to bless those that are fearing him.
Amen.
He's looking for somebody to bless, not somebody to kill.
Amen.
I'm going to say it again. He's looking for somebody to bless. He's looking for a woman to bless. He's looking for a man to bless. He's looking for a child to bless. He's looking for a family to bless. He's looking for a church to bless. He's looking for a believer who will simply trust in my faith and do what he says to do. He's looking for that type of vessel because he wants to bless that kind of a vessel. He wants to elevate that kind of a vessel. He wants to use that kind of a vessel. He wants to, listen, knock your socks off. You haven't experienced this type of usage. You haven't experienced this time of blessing. You haven't even experienced this level of glory with God, walking with God, until you buckle down and simply do what God says to do. God will knock your socks off.
Yes, sir.
And you won't have to work for it.
Yes, sir.
Putting in hours after hours on the job for the man. I got a man that will bless your life if you put him first in your life. His name is Jesus. All you got to do is do what he says to do. All you got to do is love him with all of your heart. All you got to do is let him lead your life because he's taking you somewhere.
Whole lot of
stuff. I hear a whole lot of religious talk. On one hand, I trust God, but no! No, there's no but after trusting God. I trust God, period.
Yes, amen.
I have no other options. I need no other options. I need nothing else to consider. I trust God, period. That's the way I live my life. And when you and I buckle down and actually own our faith like that, I'm here to tell you that his eye is looking. Oh, they're ready. They're ready. Let me pour out a blessing on them. Oh, they finally got it. It took them 15 years to really get to this point of trusting me, but here I am, ready to pour out blessing on them. Oh, they've been crying for the last 5 years. I know they've been down in the dumps, but I've got a blessing, and they're ready to receive it. Let me tell you something. When you and I grow to that point in our lives, that's when God begins to use that eye. And bless us.
Yes, amen.
Is there anybody in this room today that needs a blessing from God?
Amen.
I ain't playing with you. I ain't faking. Anybody need a blessing from God? Raise it like you really need it.
Amen.
Raise your hand like you really need it. Like he's passing it out in the room today. Because he is. His eye is looking. Who can I bless? Who's ready to receive the provision of God? Who's ready to receive what I have for them? Let me tell you something. God is not an unjust God. He's a good God. Why is he a good God? Because he wants to bless you. But that blessing is attached to obedience. That's the message. It's attached to obedience. I wish I could stand here and detach it and say, God gonna bless you anyhow. Yeah, he might bless you with surface level stuff where you get up and see the next day and you got strength to get in your car and drive to work and do the same old, same old.
That's right.
I'm not talking about that.
That's right.
He gives unbelievers that same privilege.
Yes, sir.
He blesses them with the same sun that shines on us, the same rain that falls on us. He provides them with the same things on that level. I ain't talking about that normal level.
That's right. Speak, Lord.
God's trying to get us to shift to another level of glory.
Yes.
Where we stop expecting the same things that unbelievers expect from God.
That's right.
We become just like the world.
Yes.
We become just like unbelievers.
Yes.
And when it doesn't rain, it's a drought, we get upset just like unbelievers.
Yes.
Over the same temporary stuff that they get bothered by. But you and I need to understand. unlocked. Listen to me. Those blessings are unlocked because of obedience. Faith.
That's right.
You've heard it. It's the key. You and I have to be obedient to God.
Amen.
And let me be clear, because the Bible says, listen, you and I just can't hear this and walk away and act like we didn't hear it. Because the Bible declares that him that knoweth to do good and doeth it not, that's the King James English. Let me put it in my ears. If you know what's right and you still do what's wrong, you're just as wrong as two left shoes. That's what God says. You can't fool him. You can't pull a wool over his eyes with your many excuses. And I got a whole lot of excuses too. And God has been challenging me. Stop talking excuse. Stop giving me that excuse. I've heard it too many times.
That's right.
Amen. That's right.
Thank you. How old do you have to be spiritually to do what I tell you to do? How much more do I have to really do in your life to get you to a point of obedience? What else do I have to do to cultivate your heart so that you actually do what I tell you to do?
No.
I mean to tell you, God doesn't have to do one more thing. He doesn't have to teach us one more thing. Well, Lord, if I just understand Leviticus, then I'll be a little bit more, you know, in line with your will, and my faith will be increased. You know, that I need a faith boost. No, you don't need anything. You just need to simply eat what you already got. Digest what you already got. Listen, let it get in you so that it can produce faith. Because the Bible doesn't say he uses people with great faith. He doesn't say he uses people with monumental faith. The Bible says he uses people with a small amount of faith. And all you need is a little bit of faith. Because if we integrate that faith with his authority of his word, that will be enough to germinate that seed and allow that to become faith-producing power. And God honors faith of any size. My fear is that a whole lot of folk today have no faith. A whole lot of profession, but no faith. A whole lot of talk. A whole lot of amen. Hallelujah. And no faith. Because how do you know, preacher? What do you do when you get in trouble? What do you do? How do you act when you get in trouble? How do you act when you get in a battle? How do you act when you get, listen, stressed out? How do you act when you get in a turmoil and when you get in struggle and stress? Things that strain your very faith, your life. Because what's in you is going to come out of you. This is the reality. So examine what you say versus what you do. Examine what you boast to other believers to appear to be spiritual versus really what's in your heart and what you really want to say. Because some of us, we ain't testified right yet. Some of our testimonies need to be a whole lot deeper, and sometimes they wouldn't be fit for church. Y'all ain't going to talk to me today. A whole lot of us have a whole lot of real stuff we want to say in our testimonies. But we can't say it in church, because it ain't church rated. It ain't churchy enough. It ain't soft enough for church. And everybody's ears ain't tuned into hearing your real reality.
Amen.
But God sees, and God knows. And if we'll simply be obedient to God, I'm here to tell you today, Baraka, it doesn't take long for God to pour out his blessing. How long does it take to get a bottle, open a cap? That's good water. It's not as good as Fuji. How long does it take to drink? It's a decision of your will. How long does it take to be obedient to God? It's a decision of your will.
Amen.
And then how long does it take for God to pour out his blessing on you? He's already made a decision of his will. He wants to bless you. And here's what, I'm going to close with it. I had a third point, but I'm not going to go there. Here's what it ought to be life-changing for all of us today. If we let God bless us like that, the product of being blessed will show the world that it really does pay to serve Jesus.
Amen.
I'm not talking about a Rolls Royce and Bentley and a jet. No. I'm talking about the favor of God on your life.
Yes.
God doesn't bless you in private and you're just in your own quiet closet in your house. And no, he blesses you publicly.
Yes.
He heals us publicly.
Yes, he does.
He uses us publicly. He wants to favor us publicly.
Yes.
But we got to make a public declaration.
That's it.
That Christ is taking us somewhere. God is taking us somewhere.
Yes.
And we're on board for the ride.
Yes.
We're moving forward with God.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
We're moving forward with God's word. How much time do you spend in Bible study, prayer? Again, some of you I've never seen at a Wednesday night prayer service. And you drive. You ain't scared of the dark. Maybe one. But that's all right. But here's the thing. Since she was like, I'm just picking on you. She doesn't drive at night.
I'm curling up my
toes. Here's the thing. Are you committed beyond anything else? Again, putting excuses aside, because if you and I will connect with God, take you somewhere. Stop always wanting to be strong in the Lord. Stop always wanting to be strong in the Lord.
My Lord, help us, Jesus.
Or let me go here. Stop thinking you're strong in the Lord. He said, Preacher, why you say that? Why you say that? I am. If you don't spend time in God's word, you ain't.
That's right.
I don't even have to know you. If you don't spend time with God's word, and I'm not talking about privately, because you can't do everything by yourself.
That's right.
That's why the church exists.
That's right.
If you never connect, hear me good,
because
we have some in this church that have never connected like this.
Yes.
If you've never connected with a body of born-again believers, in the study of God's word and in a fervent prayer, then you're not doing what God has called you to do.
That's right.
Amen.
You don't have to say amen. I know I'm right.
That's right.
If you never, I mean never, it's not even a priority, a blip on your radar. I need to study God's word. I need to pray with the saints.
Amen.
Since we all going somewhere. Get on the bus.
Right.
Don't say you're going somewhere walking by the bus because the bus going to leave you.
Right.
Sounds good, but you ain't on the bus.
That's right.
See, the folk on the bus are together.
Yes.
The folk on the bus are united.
Yes.
There's no division on where the progress is. We're going where the bus driver's taking us, and Jesus is our bus driver. He's taking us somewhere. All I'm saying, get on board.
That's right.
Because we're moving forward. I said we're moving forward.
That's right.
With God.
Yes.
My prayer is all of us are moving forward with God.
Amen.
Together.
Yes.
All heads bowed, all eyes closed. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray now that this is the message you've given to me to give. I pray, oh God, that you would massage this truth down in every heart. Wake up every callous, cold, indifferent mind and heart. Soften it. Loosen up the fallow ground. Break it up by the authority of God's word. Lower the hammer so that the seed of the truth of God's word might get in. The agenda right now is to plant the seed, because you promised that you would bring the water. Just like you did for Israel, I'm going to lead you to a place where I'm going to provide for you. I pray right now that you would provide clarity in every heart and mind right now in this room to say yes to the authority and the truth of God's word. I pray, oh God, that no heart would be left hard or cold, callous, or indifferent. But Father, we would all be sensitive to what your word says. And I pray, oh God, for faith to be germinated. I pray for faith to grow. I pray for faith, God, to produce life-changing change in our lives right now. Before I conclude this prayer, maybe that's you this morning, and God has been chipping away at your heart. He's been digging around the soil of your heart. He's preparing you, and you know He's preparing you. But you've been ignoring the preparation. You know the bus is going to leave, but you've been taking your own sweet time. Today God is saying, I want to take you into my will for your life. You got to say, yeah, I want to go. I want to be a part of your kingdom, agenda. I want to move forward in my life. Maybe there's somebody here today. Preacher, I've been stagnant, stuck. I've been in the past. I don't know where I am, but I'm not on the bus. And right now, I want to get where God is. Is that you? Just raise your hand. I want to pray for you. We're not here to shame anybody. We're here to pray for you because God wants to bless you, and we want to get you in a position where God can bless you. So you and I have to move in obedience. Maybe it's an obedience issue. Maybe you've been, your will is stronger than God's will. Your way is better than God's way, and you need to get past that today and simply say, yeah, to the will of God. I see that hand. Listen, if God is pricking your heart, throw that hand in the air right now. I want to pray over you. I want to believe God for your deliverance. I want to believe God, listen, for your growth, for the strength of the Lord to be real in your life. Is there another? Preacher, pray for me. I need God to do a work in my life, my heart right now. Thank you. God bless you. I see that hand. Is there another? I just want to be serious with God right now. I see that hand. God bless you. God bless you. Ain't no harm to be real and transparent in the house of God. Let God do something, but you got to first acknowledge where you are. Is there another before I close out? I want to pray over you. If you raise your hand, would you stand to your feet right where you are? I just want to pray over you. If you raise your hand, with all heads bowed, all eyes are closed, and I want believers everywhere, be praying right now. As I pray out loud, you be praying in your heart. Father, in the name of Jesus, the matchless name of Jesus, I pray over every saint that is standing right now, child of God that knows you. I pray, oh God, for their strength right now to let go of anything, any excuses, any mindset, any issue of the past that's keeping them, Father, from moving forward with God. And I pray, oh God, that you would liberate them right now in the name of Jesus. Liberate them right now. Set them free by the power of the gospel that they might walk in newness of life in these areas of their lives. And God, you know what they are. I don't have to know, but you do. And I pray right now a release in their spirit. I pray right now a release in their hearts. I pray, oh God, your power, your anointing to fall upon them in those areas of doubt, fear, worry, anxiety, whatever it is, God, that's keeping them from moving forward. I pray, oh God, that they would become obedient followers of Jesus Christ, even when it doesn't make sense to their logic, even when it doesn't make sense economically, even when it doesn't make sense with their lives. I pray, oh God, that you would lift them from their own understanding and allow them to realize that you've got a plan that will blow their minds. You've got an agenda that will shape their world as they know it. I pray over each and every one of them right now, and I claim the victory for them on their behalf in the name of Jesus. And I count it as done. Amen and amen. Let's stand on our feet. Hallelujah. Come on, put your hands together and give God a praise.